va passer à présent à notre troisième et dernier panel. Merci beaucoup, les suivants peuvent prendre place. Un dernier panel consacré à la prospérité et à la lutte contre les inégalités économiques. Alors on va vous présenter toutes et tous, certains sont avec nous en duplex, en direct. Nous avons Patrick Taran, voilà, vous pouvez déjà vous asseoir, bienvenue. Vous êtes président du Global Migration Policy Associates, spécialiste des migrations internationales, ancien fonctionnaire à l'OIT dans le domaine des migrants. Bonsoir et soyez le bienvenu. Chantal Payer nous rejoint, bonsoir. Alors vous êtes chef de l'équipe Entreprise et Droits de l'Homme au sein de l'ONG Pain pour le Prochain et vous avez évidemment joué un rôle important dans l'initiative multinationale responsable. Initiative, on le rappelle également, refusée dans les urnes, comme quoi la démocratie des fois ne va pas toujours dans le sens des engagements qu'on peut prendre, aussi noble soit la cause. Et bonsoir Raymond Saner. Vous êtes directeur du Centre for Economic Development, CSEND, et vous œuvrez de concert avec les Nations Unies pour la mise en œuvre des objectifs de développement durable au sein des entreprises. Comment améliorer les traités internationaux? Qu'est-ce qui existe déjà? Qu'est-ce qui reste à faire? Quel rôle peut jouer l'OCDE également en matière de gestion d'institutions financières? Alors, c'est très intéressant parce qu'on verra avec vous qu'un certain nombre de règles existent, un certain nombre de réglementations existent et qu'il ne reste plus qu'à les appliquer. J'ai envie de vous passer la parole, Raymond, puisqu'on parlait d'organisation. Voilà, vous connaissez très concrètement hein, en quoi consiste l'organisation même des textes, des traités, un certain nombre de choses existent. Le chemin est encore long, évidemment, pour lutter contre les inégalités économiques, d'autant qu'aujourd'hui, on voit que la crise Covid n'a pas forcément amélioré la situation de ce point de vue-là. Mais est-ce qu'il y a un socle quand même qui nous rassemble, une direction dans laquelle on va? Est-ce que vous sentez cette énergie?
Je pense.
Bien. Thank you. Je pense, mais tout d'abord, je voulais dire, c'est un plaisir, Jérémy, de vous voir ici sur scène avec nous. En général, je vous écoute, je vous vois sur l'écran et j'apprécie beaucoup les émissions que vous aviez organisées.
D'ailleurs. Merci beaucoup.
Et merci aussi pour les organisateurs de m'avoir invité de parler sur un sujet qui me tient à cœur. Et je vais continuer en anglais parce que je pense aux autres qui nous écoutent de loin. Et c'est un sujet où il y a aussi une certaine terminologie que je veux être absolument sûr que je ne vais pas confondre ce que je veux en fait passer comme message. So, yes, once upon a time, there was a certain gentleman called Milton Friedman. He got a Nobel Prize for being an excellent economist, one people thought at that time. And he came up with this saying, among other excellent books, but he also coined the term, business is in business to do business. And that's all. Well, if we continue with this in interpretation, of what the private sector is all about, of course, we got a little problem. And that is, if it leads to profit maximization for the shareholders who own a company, then of course, all our discussions maybe are in vain. Because we know that some companies produce so-called externalities, right? They produce polluted water. Air that we can't breathe. They say yes to work conditions which are horrible. There are certain things they are not obliged to improve or to do differently because there's no law which says thou shalt not do this extreme form of exploitation of nature as well as of human beings. Now, I'm not saying private sector and business are all evil beings who just are out only on making a buck and wanting to, you know, stash money into their pockets and be profit maximizers. There are many decent, excellent business people who also bear in mind there is more to being in business than just to make money. A lot of them came up with the idea of corporate social responsibility. That is basically the idea that a company can also do good for society while at the same time be in business. It's not a contradiction. Right? However, as was the surprise of a gentleman called Emmanuel Faber, who was the CEO of a big transnational company called Danone. He was into corporate social responsibility. However, a small group of shareholders who really still kept with Milton Friedman's concept that the business is just there to make money, nothing else. The rest should be done by others, meaning society or maybe missionaries or whatever, who can take care of the damage caused if we don't take into account the whole idea of what business means. He got ousted in March, and immediately the share price of Danone went up by 2.3%, which of course is understandable to some extent if the company does not anymore, quote, waste money doing corporate social responsibility, it will generate a higher profit, which could be beneficial for the shareholders. There's something about corporate social responsibility. There is the risk that some shareholders don't like it, or that the CEO gets replaced and the next one will go back to old style business as business and nothing else. So people have thought about what could be done that's more consistent, more sustainable, and less dependent on one man or woman who has maybe great ideas, tries to implement it, but then gets ousted. So people have thought about it, including our governments. And the first initiative was 10 years ago at the level of the United Nations. There was this thing called United Nations Guiding Principles of what business should do in regards to respecting human rights. This has been accepted by all of the 193 governments, and in that sense is being implemented, or a lot of governments and countries try to implement these guiding principles. But there is also, of course, more to being a good company. To do good, to respect certain conditions which are good for the company and also for society. So there is something else called the OECD Guiding Principles for Responsible Business Conduct. It's a long formula, but basically it means also for business to respect, for instance, human rights. And in addition, it has a broader scope to also not engage in environmental pollution or activities which could harm the environment. Also not to practice corruption. Also in that sense, not to use too much tax evasion to reduce the income that maybe local communities could expect from the activities of a transnational company. So in other words, it's broader than the United Nations guiding principles. It's a bit more consistent than corporate social responsibility. But unfortunately, only 40 countries have signed up to it. There are still the UN that means 193 countries. There are countries such as China. We think about China as a competitor. Well, to some extent, the idea of doing things more reasonably, you know, more mindfully, to be sustainable, of course, some companies rightfully so say, well, if we all do this, we'll have more costs, as I mentioned before with the CEO of Danone. So why should we do all this? When the Chinese and the Russians and all the others and the Indians, they don't practice the same rules, we'll become less competitive. So we'll have to further discuss how do we create something which makes sense for the survival of the planet, but also for the dignity of the people who are also practicing, of course, business, but also are in that sense consumers and also expect some certainty that we don't run into eco-suicide, but there is a future for the next generation. Now, things have further improved from my point of view. It's one thing to have good intentions, like corporate social responsibility. It's another to meet at the UN and to agree on treaties. But treaties like the UN and at the OECD are non-binding. In other words, nobody is obliged to actually implement them. They're meant to be good ideas. So the final step is what is now particularly happening in the Netherlands. The Netherlands are really ahead of us compared to other countries, including my own Switzerland. They have passed national laws. And based on national laws, one being, for instance, we, Netherlands, we have signed up to the Paris Agreement. So be it. Let's do it. They passed a law which expects companies to not be CO2 emissioner, to do things which I already now described to you about the OECD guidelines. They have now taken to court a big bank, for instance, ING. And ING had to accept that its annual publication, which reports about what the company is doing, was not good enough. Simply was a bit of greenwashing and bluewashing. That they would be more specific as to what they do in terms of trying to reduce CO2 emissions. And, which is never happened yet before anywhere else, that the bank itself, over the next 6 years, will gradually move out of investing in the coal industry. We had a similar rule also recently in the Netherlands about Shell. And Shell had to agree to reduce its CO2 emissions. I forgot, but I think 35% over the next 4 years. These are tremendous steps forward, from my point of view, to turn everything we talked about that we want to do to make the world a better place, to actually do it. And to let business, as well as society, know what is expected. So we are specific, and it helps investors and business to know what the rules are of doing business, and it's not just to be in business for business. That concludes my contribution.
Merci beaucoup, Raymond.